Okay, so last week we saw the Varna Dharma. Although I initially thought maybe we will do both of them in a session, I realize already I'm going fast in many of the topics. But Sanatana Dharma is so fast, so vast. We are trying to, make use of some 10, 12 sessions and trying to get a glimpse of it. Anyway, so this week, what we will do is we will continue on the Varnashrama Dharma, but of course we have seen the Varna and we'll see another important concept called Ashrama Dharma. So little bit of quick recapitulation we will do and then move on. So we spoke about these two dimensions of our life last week. So there is the spatial dimension on, let us say, on the y-axis, and the temporal dimension on the x-axis. We saw the spatial dimension, which is how do I sort of spend time. I preach and practice, I acquire knowledge, preach and practice, or I inspire people, Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra, and those kinds of varnas. And today we will see the temporal dimension, which means notwithstanding whatever position in this row, four rows, we need to, this dotted line and arrow is showing that we need to travel from womb to tomb. From the time we are born to the time we breathe our last, we have to travel. And today we are going to talk about the traveling business. That is the time dimension or the temporal dimension, which we will see. Now, just to summarize our understanding of Varna Dharma. First of all, please understand all are not equal, all are not same, but all are unique. That is what Varna is actually bringing to the table. I mean, this modern day communists, they're all very, short-sighted people. They say all are equal. And I jokingly say, you know what it means? It means all are equal. They were not able to make all of them Kuberas. They were very successful in making all of them Kushelas, make them all of them poor. So they bring all of them to the lowest common denominator. That's what they were trying. That's a very uninteresting idea. But all of us are unique. We have our own unique capabilities, which is what the Varna is actually trying to capture. So the five fingers are not identical. Even if these five fingers were identical, we would have had great trouble in using it. It should be different. One should be thick and small, one should be long and all that. This indicates Varna is a very natural phenomenon. Second thing we should remember is we are satisfied person in life only when we are able to align ourselves to our true nature. So Varna is again helping us to do that. It does not talk about birth certificate. It does not talk about what you do. It talks about how do you profess yourself by bringing the best of what you are. That's the second. The third thing Varna also says is skills and competence must be matched and with roles and responsibilities. Those beautiful definitions of Bhagavad Gita chapter 18. You should look at it very carefully. Modern day competency mapping are all similar to what is written in that Bhagavad Gita. For each Varna, there is a clear expectations of what is there, what is a competency, and so on. That is another dimension of Varna. Rewards and punishments are commensurate positions. I showed you that example, which there was a question also which we talked about it. And most importantly, all the four are complementary to one another. See, if you take a human body and like that BBC figure, and what these Dravidians in Tamil Nadu also are saying, the DMK parties and so on. If you think head is superior to your foot, it shows your level of ignorance. It all has to work together. Then only this is a very, useful piece of flesh, which can make difference to life. So all are complementary to one another. There's nothing like superiority or inferiority. If people are pointing to it, they are bringing what is in their mind. Vishwam darpana drishyamana nagari tulyam. The world is a mirror. You only, see yourself in the mirror. So when people make such statements, that is what they are going through. Because the world is only a mirror. Whereas Varna system is not like that. It's a very composite kind of a complementary kind of a system. So I want you to once again remind and you know recapitulate these notions of dharma. So varna dharma is done, engaging with the world. Now let's talk about evolving over time. I mean, this is a very, very important requirement. Please do not tell me that I am born, I am 4 years old, I am 5 years old, and then somebody taught me what is 2 plus 2. They say 2 in the mind, 2 in the hand, after 2, 3, 4. Please don't tell me in PhD, when I'm doing PhD, if I have to find out what is 2 plus 2, I should not say 2 in the mind and 2 in the hand and after 2, I have not evolved. This is a very simple example. I'm saying it's our inherent nature to evolve. Now, our ancestors did not measure evolution by the bank balance, which is the modern paradigm. Our ancestors never measured whether you evolved by seeing what is your bank balance or what is how often you change your visiting card or how much immovable assets. These are all you know hedonistic pleasures which the Western world has taught us in recent thing. We had a lot of hedonistic pleasures, but they were governed by a larger principle. We will see it in one of the sessions later. When we talk of Purusharthas, we are going to go there. But the point is that I'm making is the evolution that our ancestors talked about is critically linked to the evolution of the soul in the context of the karma theory. Meaning, I should make this progress. This soul must keep moving on and on and find ways by which it is able to clean up its karma. Shuddhi karna. It's able to clean up itself, and therefore the chances are that all that, you know, that figure which I showed you, this is also linked to that. So that is how they looked at this evolution over time. So that is called ashrama dharma.